Today I want to share a new draft design about embedded files for Go. Now what do I mean by embedded files? I mean inserting a file into your program at build time so that you can access that file's contents from the image of your own program without having to have that file be present on the system that you're running on later. And doing this, inserting a file into a program, is a very old idea. I just reach for a couple examples that I had at hand. This is from 6th edition Unix. This is the very first program that the kernel runs when it starts up. It needs to get a program from somewhere to get going. Most programs are created by forking the running program, but the very first program can't be forked from nothing. And so this is the actual file that the kernel pretends is in the memory space of the running program. But this is exactly the same format as you would read from disk. It's just a raw executable file. It happens to be written as a sequence of octal words. But this is the program that starts up. And this was a handwritten file embedded in a program. Many years later for Plan 9, we had the same problem. Every Unix kernel has this problem. And in Plan 9, the make file runs this code. It actually builds a real executable instead of handwriting one. And then it runs a hex dump and formats it back into working C code and writes out this file in it.h, which then gets included into the kernel. If you want to do this on your own system, there's probably a utility called xxd installed, which is, I guess, an extended hex dump utility. And so if you write hello world into hello.txt, and then you run xxd, it will spit out this C code. And then if you have some other C code that knows what that C code looks like and declares the right declarations and uses it, and you build it, there you have a hello world. And this program read from the virtual hello text file that was embedded in the program as a data variable. We can do this in Go as well. There are tools today. One of the oldest ones is called Go bin data. And so if I, again, initialize hello.txt and I run Go bin data, it generates actually a fair amount of Go code. It's not just a variable declaration. It's got a whole API for accessing these files. And so if I write this hello.go with this call must asset, which brings in the named asset embedded file hello.txt and returns it, and we convert it to a string and print it, we have a hello.world program or hello world program. There are many other tools in the Go ecosystem for doing this. This is just a small list. This is clearly a need that lots of people have, not just Go programmers, but Go programmers are certainly inventing their own tools to do this. The problem that all these tools have is that you have to run them, and they write out Go source code, and then that Go source code has to get checked into your repo. And so it's annoying to remember to run them. It's annoying to check in the code into your repo when you've already got the other files. But the tools can't do anything about that because it's forced on them by the Go command. If the problem is there are these tools that you have to remember to run to generate Go source code that you have to check in, sort of obvious answer is, well, why not have the Go command do that for you? The Go command could run the tools and consume the source code, and then you wouldn't have to check it in. You wouldn't have to remember to run the tools. But we don't do that. We do provide a tool or a mode for running the generators. You can run Go generate, and that will explicitly run any generators mentioned in your source code. But we don't run that automatically. And you might wonder, why do we not do that? And there are three answers. One is that we want to keep the build simple. Next, we want to keep the builds reproducible. And finally, we want to keep the build safe. Now, by simple, I just mean that my clients of my library, if I publish a library, they don't need all the tools that I have if I check in the code that those tools generated. And so that greatly simplifies the task of actually building my program. Like maybe I'm using a Go generator that actually only works on Linux. It produces perfectly portable code, but the program itself only runs on Linux. Then all the Windows users would be in trouble. But if I just check in the generated source code, we don't have that problem. Similarly, we want the builds to be reproducible. So, if the tool somehow behaved differently, or if the user got a different version of the tool, or if it did something different on Windows, or if it did something different on Tuesdays, we avoid all of those problems by just checking in the Go source code you're supposed to get from the tool instead of rerunning the tool every time we do a build. And finally, we want to keep builds safe. We we want to make sure that people giving you source code can't cause arbitrary code to run during your build. Obviously, if you build an executable and then you run it, and that executable has, you know, someone else's source code in it, you're running their source code implicitly. You're implicitly trusting them. But we draw a hard line between the build and then running the binary or running tests. And for the build itself, we really want to guarantee that only the Go tool chain and those tools that you already have on your system are running, not arbitrary other tools that anyone who can check in code into any of your dependencies has control over listing. And all of these are a big part of why the Go ecosystem and Go get interoperate so well, is that we've kept the download and build model very, very simple. We want to preserve that. So external tools can't avoid this problem that you have to run them to generate Go source code that has to get checked in. But we can avoid that problem if we put the functionality into the Go command itself. And for something that is as widespread a need as embedding files into the Go command, it probably makes sense to do this. And so this is the way that we have in the draft design to do this. We have a file, hello.txt, and then we have a Go program. And that Go program declares a variable of type embed.files. And then above it, it puts a directive in that's respected by the Go command and the compiler that says embed hello.txt into this embed.files when the program is being compiled. And then later when it's run, it can call greeting.readfile to get the hello.txt back out and then print it out. And so here we have a hello world program. And so the whole point of this draft design is that maybe we should do this, and we're trying to get feedback on what you think. Now, in addition to just being able to embed the files and read them back out, we of course want that to fit well with the rest of the Go standard library and really the rest of the ecosystem. And so one reason that people embed files is to serve them over HTTP. Another reason is to parse them as templates. Or they might want to use them with some other third-party package. And for all these reasons, or for all these use cases, we want to make sure that the embed files works as smoothly as native operating system files, ideally. So here's another example. We have our embed files named content now. We embed hello.txt, and then we want to turn that into a handler so that we can serve it or you know, attach it to a certain URL. And so here we have the handler, and then when we run this program, we can read from this URL and we get the hello world back. Before I go much further, I want to emphasize this is a draft design. It's not a proposal. This would be a large change in the terminology that I introduced last year. It is user visible. It requires changes to documentation, and it affects multiple packages. It affects packages that want to consume the embed files. It also affects all these tools that exist. Hopefully it will simplify them or maybe make certain ones not needed anymore. We want to get feedback on this draft design outside of the pressure of the proposal process. And so if the feedback is overwhelmingly positive, or if there are changes we have to make and then the feedback is overwhelmingly positive, then we'll add it to the proposal process at that point. And then, you know, hopefully it won't be very contentious because we've already taken the feedback and responded to it and made changes that we need to make. And, you know, if everything went super smoothly, like maybe you would see this in Go 1.16, or maybe we decide this isn't worth doing. Or maybe it would happen in a later release. We don't know. It's still a draft design. So here's the design. You've basically already seen all the pieces. There's this new Go embed comment, a directive comment, and this is using the syntax that we already use in the toolchain for other directive comments. There's a new package that you import as embed that defines embed.files. There's support in the Go command and the compiler to stitch this all together and get the files copied into the package binary when the package is compiled, and then from there into the executable that you build. And then there's changes to the go/build package and the golang.org xtools go packages package to give tools that work on your Go programs the ability to see what's going on so that, you know, they can understand better how the program is built. You've already seen the comment. As far as the details, the comment has to precede the var declaration of type embed.files. It's okay to have other blank lines and other line comments in between those two, but otherwise, you know, they need to be next to each other in the file. And this comment tells the go command to tell the compiler to pre-fill the embed.files variable with the files that are named. And the argument to go embed is a glob pattern in the style of path.match. And it's okay to name a directory. If you name a directory, you get all the files and directories in that directory recursively. You cannot refer to dot or dot dot or empty directories or subdirectories that are part of other modules. And that just makes sure that it works really well with the module system. And it's fine to use the go embed comment on global variables and on local variables. We've seen one of each already in the examples. And it's also fine to use them in tests. They work fine in tests. Here's the embed package. There's a single type, files. And files has two methods, open and read file. The open method means that files implements the new fs.fs interface, which is the subject of a different draft design, which I'll put a link to under this video. And then the read file method is just a helper to make it more convenient if you just want to grab file contents, which is a very common thing to do. The implementation of the fs.fs interface, you know, satisfying that interface, means that the embed files already will plug into packages that expect or know about that interface, like HTTP and HTML template. And that's how those were getting connected in the example before. As another example, suppose you have templates that you want to embed into your binary and then parse at startup time from your program. We can declare an embed.files. We can embed everything from the images and templates directories. And then at runtime, we can call template.parsefs, pass in the set of files, and say we want to parse template slash star.tumble for the template, so it will ignore, you know, the images and the other things that don't match that glob pattern. As far as the go command changes, obviously the main change is to actually implement the functionality we've been talking about. All of that is basically invisible except that the functionality works. In addition to that, for tooling, we want to expose a couple more fields to go list. So if you run go list and you ask for .embed patterns or .embed files, it will give you the list of strings that are the patterns that are passed to go embed anywhere in the package, or the files that those match. And so in this example, the patterns were hstar.txt and images, which names a directory, and then the files are the hello.txt and a gopher image. In addition to these new changes for go list, there's other tooling that's built on the go slash build package, and importantly, the go command, and then also the xtools go packages package. And so in go slash build, whose job is to really gather the immediate information about source files on disk, but not like larger context, it's what the go command is built on top of. In go slash build, we have to expose the patterns themselves from the source files. And there's three different new fields that say the go embed patterns in the main source code, in the test, and in the external test files. And then, you know, then you have the go command, and then the go packages package, which is what most tooling uses, queries the go command, but it provides a more streamlined API. It always talks about specific packages, even test packages show up as just different packages. And so the only thing we need to add there is just this list of files that are the direct files embedded. Now, there are lots of other designs that you could imagine going with. We already talked about why we don't just run go generate automatically during builds, but there's lots of other things specific to embedding files that you might imagine adding if you were going to do a design. And there was an early discussion last year on issue 35950 that just sort of explored the design space of what's possible. And there are lots of things listed that I want to flag as like explicitly out of scope, because the goal here is to provide the base support for here is a file, get it into my binary. And any kind of munging of that file sort of starts to run back into, well, this is stuff that can't be built into the go command, so it really needs to be in external tools. Because it's just, there's too many knobs, there's too many things you'd want to do, too many ways you'd want to adjust this. So we're focused on just get the files into the binary, and other tools can prepare the files and leave them on disk. So things that are out of scope include data compression, JavaScript minification, TypeScript compilation, image resizing, sprite map generation, UTF-8 normalization, curlif normalization, all of these things were brought up. And there's lots of other design questions that you could imagine. So if you have a question about, well, why don't we do this as well? The draft design talks more about many of those things, so I would suggest checking that. As a bonus, just to wrap up, here is a self-reproducing program. It embeds itself and then pulls itself out and then prints itself. And similarly, here is the self-reproducing web server. It has embedded itself and then it can serve itself. And if you fetch localhost 8000 and give it the file name, it will spit back its own source code. So to wrap up, this is again a draft design. It's not a proposal. We need feedback from everyone first. The basic idea is to add direct Go command support for embedding files into binaries. And this relies heavily on the file system interface's draft design, which there's also a video for, and I'll link at the bottom. And that helps us integrate all the embed.files into other parts of the library without those parts knowing explicitly what an embed.files is. They just take a generic file system. There are details in a doc, and we'll run the Q&A on Reddit, because Reddit has better threading support than GitHub, and it seemed to work pretty well last time. And thanks very much for watching.